Good afternoon, everyone. Can I remind all members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the campus? So I would ask that everyone observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. The next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on the update on drugs policy. And the First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Nicola Sturgeon for up to 15 minutes, please, First Minister.
Thank you. In 2019, the number of people in Scotland who died a drug-related death was equivalent to three people losing their lives each and every day. Every single one, 1,264 in total, was a human being with dreams and aspirations, talent and potential. They were all someone's mother, father, daughter, son, brother or sister. Each of them left a hole in the lives of those who loved them. They mattered. And while we can't help them now, we must do much more to make sure others don't suffer the same fate. The fact is, all of these people and those who died in years gone by were in some way failed by us. Responsibility for that rests first and foremost with government. And the failure is not just a moment in time. Anyone who ends up losing their life as a result of drug addiction is not just failed at the time of their death. In most cases, they will have been failed repeatedly throughout their whole lives. I believe that if we have the will, we can and we will find the ways to stop this happening. But doing so requires a national mission to end what is currently a national disgrace. It is a reasonable criticism to say that this government should have done more earlier, and I accept that. But I am determined that we will provide this national mission with the leadership, focus and resources that it needs. To help with this, I have appointed Angela Constance as a minister dedicated to leading this work and reporting directly to me. She will work with the Drugs Death Task Force, which is already doing very good work, and I want to take this opportunity to thank everyone contributing their time and expertise to it. Part of Angela's task will be ensuring that this work is embedded across all areas of government, but particularly in our efforts to improve mental health, tackle homelessness, and ensure a humane and responsive justice system. She will also lead work with partners across the country, and in particular with grassroots and third sector organisations. And she will ensure that we listen more to those with real-life experience of drug addiction, those who live or have lived with addiction, and also with their families who so valiantly try to support them. We will also work to tackle all aspects of this problem. The focus of my statement today is on treatment and support services, but there are many other areas that will require improvement too. For example, like many MSPs, I know that the widespread availability of benzodiazepines, street benzos, is scarring too many of our communities. That's why Angela Constance and Police Scotland are urgently considering with people from those communities what more we can do to address that issue. And we do recognise that this requires not just action to disrupt supply, important though that is, but also improvements to treatment that are necessary to stem demand. We will also do more to tackle head-on the stigma that is still too often associated with drug use. Stigma doesn't just affect people's sense of their own value, although that is in itself damaging. It also discourages people from coming forward to get the help and services they need. So we must remember at all times that people addicted to drugs are family members, neighbours and colleagues. Addiction is, of course, very often linked to poverty and deprivation, but it could affect any family, including our own. Stigma is therefore one of the issues Angela Constance and I discussed with the Drugs Death Task Force last week. By addressing it and the silence and alienation it causes, we make it more possible for people to seek help, and I think that will benefit all of us. Last week's discussion with the task force, together with other discussions we've had in recent weeks, was hugely helpful. They have provided us with a clear sense of the issues we need to work on most urgently. We know there is a lot of work ahead. Now, today's statement can only be a start to this process. It cannot possibly address all of the issues that need work, and it cannot, at this stage, offer all of the answers. But I intend today to outline five key areas that will be of particular and immediate focus. But firstly, let me confirm that our actions will be backed by significant additional resources. In what remains of this financial year, until the end of March, we will provide an extra £5 million so that work can get underway urgently. Beyond that, from the start of the new financial year until the end of the next Parliament in 2026, we intend to allocate an additional £50 million of funding each year. This funding, a total of £250 million over the next Parliament, will support further investment in a range of community-based interventions, including primary prevention and an expansion of residential rehabilitation. We will also commit additional funding, if required, to improve toxicology services and enhance public health surveillance of drugs issues, which is essential to effective and timely interventions. A significant proportion of extra funding will go directly to alcohol and drug partnerships, and we expect much of it then to flow to the grassroots organisations that do so much vital work in our communities. More detail of the allocation of the funding will be set out by Angela Constance in due course, but we will adopt and expect our partners to adopt a clear focus on what works. It is important to be clear that all interventions need to be well evaluated so we know what works and what doesn't. As part of our approach, we will seek to overcome the divide that sometimes exists in public debate between harm reduction and recovery, because we think both of those things are vital. But most urgent of all is saving lives. Beyond funding, though the new funding will support all of this, there are five key areas that we need to address urgently. These include fast and appropriate access to treatment, residential rehabilitation, the creation of a more joined-up approach, one that supports people living with drug addiction to address all of the underlying challenges they face, of which drug addiction is often just the symptom, and which ensures better support after non-fatal overdoses, and also the vital role of frontline, often third sector organisations. However, I want to address at the outset the issue of safe consumption rooms. And let me take the opportunity to thank Peter Kraken for meeting with Angela and I a couple of weeks ago to share his views on this and indeed on other matters. There is strong evidence from other countries that these facilities help to prevent fatal overdoses and they encourage people who use drugs to access longer-term help. That is why we are so keen to see that model formally used here. I can confirm that we are continuing to explore how we overcome the legal barriers that currently restrict us in this respect. And while I cannot report on our conclusions of that today, it is an issue that I know Parliament will return to. However, as we do so, we will maximise what can be done now within the current law to reduce harm and stop people dying. An example of this is heroin-assisted treatment. There is evidence, again, from other places that heroin-assisted treatment reduces deaths. In addition, by taking away some of the chaos that drugs create in people's lives, heroin-assisted treatments can create the space to address other issues, such as homelessness or mental health problems. Currently, these treatments are available only to a relatively small group of people in Glasgow, where a pilot has been operating for the past year. But I can confirm today that we will make additional funding available starting in this financial year to make heroin-assisted treatment services more widely accessible across the country. The next important issue I want to address is access to treatment. Currently, only around half, and indeed according to some estimates, even less than that, of people most at risk of drug-related death are accessing drug treatment. This needs to change and fast. Part of the issue, of course, is the availability, speed and consistency of help. We must ensure that anyone who needs it has access to the type of support that works best for them, whether that is medication-assisted treatment, a psychosocial treatment, rehabilitation in the community, or rehabilitation in residential placements. For most people, of course, it will be a combination of all of these. We will therefore rapidly implement across Scotland the new standards for treatment developed by the Drugs Deaths Task Force. Funding will be provided for that in this financial year. The new standards, acknowledged as, I quote, a huge step forward by the Scottish Drugs Forum, set out the help people who use drugs should be able to expect regardless of where in Scotland they live. Crucially, the standards make clear that people must be able to start receiving support on the same day that they ask for it. The standards also stress the importance of people making informed choices about the type of medication and support available to them. Making help available and giving people an informed choice is an essential part of respecting a person's agency, rights and dignity. It's also an approach which is much more likely to be effective and provide people with the help and treatment they need. We're also taking steps to widen distribution of naloxone, the drug that we know saves lives in the event of an overdose. And we will also further increase the availability of long-acting form of opiate replacement in both prisons and in the community. We work as a matter of urgency with experts and those with lived experience to develop firm targets in relation to treatment. I mentioned at the start that at most only around half of those who need help currently get it. Undoubtedly, even fewer will get it as quickly as they should. Improving that figure significantly so that a clear majority of people who use drugs get the treatment they need when they need it has to be central to any strategy for reducing drugs deaths. The final point I want to make about treatment is that people should receive support for as long as they need it. Services must have the resources to stick with people, even when, because of their addiction, that becomes really challenging. At the moment, the number of people who drop out of support and treatment services is far too high. So we work with alcohol and drug teams to very significantly improve that over the next year. Achieving these objectives on treatment will, of course, be challenging, but it is essential and the basic aim is clear. We must empower more people to seek support. We must make that support more consistent, flexible, effective and much faster. And we must help services stick with the people they're supporting. All of this will go a long way to reducing the numbers of people who die. The third area I want to cover is residential rehabilitation. In total, around 650 people from Scotland benefited from residential rehab last year. At the moment, there are an estimated 365 rehab beds across 18 different facilities. We know that residential rehabilitation, while, and I think this is an important point, in no way the whole solution and not right for everyone, can though be an effective way of helping people with addiction. But access to it is not as readily accessible as it should be. So part of the immediate £5 million we're making available in the remaining weeks of this financial year will support the opening of additional residential rehabilitation placements. Over the course of the next Parliament, we intend to allocate an additional £20 million a year for residential rehabilitation and also associated aftercare, which is often the bit that doesn't get the same attention. We will continue, of course, to assess funding levels going forward. A significant proportion of the extra funding will go towards developing sustainable capacity in regional centres across the country. Our considerations will be inclusive of different models of care. The aim is to ensure that residential rehab is available to everyone who wants it and for whom it is deemed clinically appropriate at the time they ask for it in every part of the country. And we must ensure that rehabilitation can be provided much closer to home for people so that it is closer to the families and support networks that they so often rely on. As Angela Constance said last week, we believe that these measures will bring provision in Scotland into line with other European countries, and more importantly, they will help reduce deaths and aid recovery for hundreds of people each year. The next area I want to cover is how those working in drug services can work together better and share information more easily. One area where this is of urgent necessity is in support provided to people following a non-fatal overdose. It is a fact that many people who die as a result of drug use will have experienced non-fatal overdoses in the past. If we can provide better support after those earlier overdoses, which are themselves a clear warning sign that support is needed, then we can save lives. But that requires better cooperation and data sharing between different agencies and organisations. A good example of this kind of approach is the work being led by the Glasgow Overdose Response Team. They respond quickly to a person after a non-fatal overdose and help address immediate risks to their health while connecting them with community or clinical services in the area where they live. By making additional funding available this year, we can extend outreach initiatives like this and ensure that similar support is provided in cities across the country. In addition, by April, all alcohol and drug partnerships will have agreed a common set of steps that need to be taken to support anyone who suffers a non-fatal overdose. This will ensure that information is shared at the right time and that support is made available quickly whenever it is needed. The final point I want to address in the time I have available to me today is support for grassroots community organisations. As I said earlier, they will receive part of the additional funding that I have announced today. These organisations working on the front line, and I know this from my own constituency experience, do vital and invaluable work, but they often exist on shoestring budgets and are stretched to the limit. With extra funding, the work they do will be more secure and they will be able to do more of it and reach more people. This funding and support is important in itself, but I hope it also sends an important message that we value and support the work being done by grassroots organisations. Presiding Officer, this statement has set out a number of immediate actions. There will be more to come in the weeks ahead. But I hope it will also be heard as a statement of intent. And I hope it signals very clearly our determination to make change, to no longer fail those who need and deserve our help, but to support them instead to live their lives to the full. Right now, I spend most of my waking hours thinking about a virus, discussing and deciding the interventions necessary to protect as many people as possible from COVID. The pandemic has been all-consuming for all of us in a way that I hope no other issue will require to be in our lifetimes. But, and this is a point made already by others, this is a time to bring the same resolve, focus and common purpose that we have all shown in tackling COVID to reducing the loss of lives caused by drugs. None of us should accept drugs deaths, not a single one of them, as inevitable. And nor should we accept the heartbreak or loss of human potential that they cause and represent. Today's statement sets out new measures, it confirms additional resources, but perhaps most importantly of all, it reaffirms our resolve and underlines our belief that every single life matters. There's a lot of hard work ahead, but we are determined to make a difference and to do so quickly. We will do so in memory of all those who have died, but more importantly, we will do so to ensure that more people get the support they need to live.
First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement, and I'll allow around 30 minutes for that. It would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question could press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Drug deaths have been a growing national tragedy for more than a decade, but in the last few years, they've become Scotland's worst shame. We're now known as Europe's drug death capital, and our problem is more acute and heartbreaking than the rest of the continent and in most of the world. And more should have been done much earlier. Families have been failed, entire communities have been let down and left broken. And while today's statement will not mend all those broken families, we welcome it. We welcome what the government is bringing forward, because finally we might be able to start turning the tide and making sure that far fewer families are broken in the future. We welcome a dedicated drugs death minister, and we will work constructively with Angela Constance, as all of us want to see her succeed. We are extremely pleased that the Scottish Conservative calls for £20 million for residential rehab have been listened to. This funding is long overdue and is absolutely vital in tackling this problem. But I would like to ask the First Minister, will there be additional funding to encourage people to access rehabilitation programmes in the first place and to make medical professionals aware that extra places will be available? Will this funding announced today restore the publicly funded bed numbers to previous levels? And can the First Minister estimate how many places will be available by the end of 2021. Also, I accept that there are a number of different treatment pathways, including medication-assisted treatment and psychosocial treatment. However, there is no mention in today's statement of abstinence-based community treatment. Will the First Minister confirm that abstinence-based treatment and recovery is part of her government's vision, and that funding will be made available for abstinence treatment in general, including many projects at threat of closure, like Glasgow's Second Chance Project, who do such important work?
First Minister.
I recognised when the latest statistics were published that more should have been done. I'm not going to shy away from that. I'm determined that we can't turn back the clock, but we will bring the leadership and resolve to this. More should have been done. It's not because we don't care that more hasn't been done, but often problems, particularly of this nature, do fail to get the attention they deserve. And my view is clear, that can no longer be the case, and it will no longer be the case in the government I lead. In saying that, though, and I don't in any way want to make, and I'm not going to make party political points, but I think all of us across the political spectrum should reflect on policies that are governments, respective parties have followed in recent years, and all ask ourselves, have some of those contributed to the situation we face, and are there others that we should have followed that might have made a difference? And I have to put into that category policies around that have driven austerity, around welfare cuts, the things that exacerbate rather than alleviate poverty and deprivation. So I think there is a collective need here, recognising the primary responsibility of government, which I'm not shying away from. On the specific questions around rehab, we will restore levels of bed numbers. Angela Constance will in due course set out the precise allocation of the resources and precisely what that is going to deliver when there are further discussions we want to have with experts and those with lived experience before making all of the final decisions around that, around everything I have said today. But given the question was posed particularly about rehab, residential rehab, I'll answer it in that context. We will work with the Drugs Death Task Force, with others in drug and alcohol partnerships, to make sure there is an awareness of the increased provision and the service changes that we are making. Certainly from the discussions Angela and I had last week with the task force, they already understand, and that drugs community understands what is needed and will, I know, want to raise awareness of that. On abstinence-based community treatment, we want to make available and support what works for people. And I think one of the things that has been obvious to me for a long time in my constituency experience, but has come through very strongly in the discussions I've had in the last few weeks, is we cannot prioritise one approach over another. That's why I made the point about not giving in to distinctions between harm reduction and recovery. It is about being person-centred and working out what makes the difference for individuals and making sure that is provided and the organisations that support them are provided as well. And I think that is the right approach to take. But first and foremost, we have to stop people dying from drugs, because we can't support them to recovery, abstinence-based or otherwise, unless we first stop them dying. And that's the priority that we're setting in what we're setting out today.
Jackie Bailey.
Could I welcome the First Minister's statement? But it is tragic that it has come to this, and I welcome her acknowledgement that more needed to be done beforehand. As Health Secretary, she presided over the Road to Recovery strategy, which the Scottish Drugs Forum describe as a significant contributory factor to our present situation. And when the Scottish Government cut the budgets of alcohol and drugs partnerships, they were warned that it would lead to more deaths. Now there are 1,200 deaths in a single year. So I very much welcome the additional funding. The existing £20 million a year for treatment and support services runs out in 2021. So can the First Minister advise whether the £50 million that she's announced is in addition to the existing £20 million, or is this £30 million extra? And in terms of outcomes, what assessment has been made of the impact on reducing deaths?
First Minister.
Money I've set out today is additional money. It is new money into drugs treatment and services and the various initiatives, partly through grassroots organisations, that are important here. In terms of the analysis of the impact in deaths, we've not done a crude calculation of that, because I don't think that would be appropriate right now. We need to get the interventions right, we need to get the approaches right, we need to get the support in different services right, and then the improvement in that will flow from that. I should say the most recent, everybody knows this, the most recent drugs death statistics were for 2019. The next ones we get will be for the year that has already passed, 2020. What we are doing now clearly will not impact on those. This is about impacting from here on, saving lives literally one by one. On the point about past policies, I'm not shying away from where we've got things wrong or where we haven't done enough of the right things. But I think we do all have to reflect in the nature of debates that we all have, and I would have been guilty of this in opposition as well, when it comes to drugs in particular, of suggesting that there is one single policy that if only we adopt it or if only we stop doing it, then everything will be solved. And, you know, for example, if only we stop people being on methadone, then we solve the problems. We need to understand, as I think many do already, the complexities of this and make sure that we have the responses that are commensurate to that. And I am committed to that, and I hope others across the chamber are committed to it as well.
We move to open questions, and there are a lot of them, so please bear that in mind in questions and answers. And we have Ruth Maguire, followed by Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Practice innovations enforced by our response to the pandemic, for example, people not requiring to attend a pharmacy to have their medicine consumption supervised, illustrate clearly that where there's the leadership, will and resource, culture and practice can be changed promptly and safely, even in large systems like our health service. Can I ask if the First Minister agrees with me on that front? And if so, how the government will ensure that any gains made for people requiring treatment are maintained and indeed expanded throughout the country?
First Minister.
I agree very strongly with that. There are not many silver linings in the COVID situation. I struggle to think of any. But one of the things that is true, and it's true here, and it's true more generally, is that some of the things that the pandemic forced us to do are changes that we should have made previously, forcing virtue out of necessity, if you like. And there's no question here that people have benefited from some of the changes to previous practice that have been put in place because of COVID. So in particular, changes to pharmacy arrangements has meant that people who have been assessed as being able to, not having to attend daily for medication-assisted treatment, and that has proved highly effective. It's reduced also some of the stigma that people feel, and it's shown trust in people at the same time as reducing the risk of spreading COVID. So I think it's really important that we retain this type of arrangement going forward, and that we work with the leadership across health and with pharmacy colleagues in particular to make sure that we learn from that experience and make the most of every opportunity to improve the services and care that is offered to people. Part of the additional funding we've announced will also give delivery partners the resource and encouragement needed to ensure that we maintain and make further positive changes. But that kind of change is part of making sure that people get the access to treatment that they need, they get it quickly, and then they are able to stick with it in a way that sometimes proves very difficult right now.
Donald Cameron, followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you. The First Minister will be aware of the Project ADDA, which has been launched by the UK government as a whole system approach to tackling the cause of drug deaths with support for law enforcement, treatment and recovery. The Welsh Government has signed up to the programme, but the Scottish Government has not. Can the First Minister explain why not, and will she reconsider?
First Minister.
The task force are taking forward aspects of Project ADDA. We are not in any way ideological about these things. We will seek to work with others and learn from others and collaborate where that is appropriate. So we will continue to keep that under active consideration. I think it is right that we have an approach to this that focuses on public health, the criminal justice system. Of course, there are aspects of that that inevitably come into play here. But the more we can make this about public health and less about criminal justice, I think the more success we will have in meeting the objectives that we're setting out.
Rona Mackay, followed by Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the statement outlined, the stigma associated with drug use can prevent many people from coming forward to get the support they so badly need. Can the First Minister expand on the work that the Scottish Government and its partners are undertaking to tackle the stigma surrounding drug addiction?
First Minister.
Angela Constance and I had a very moving presentation on the work that's been done through the task force when we attended its meeting last week. They have recently published a stigma strategy which has a number of recommendations about tackling the issue, and they are taking forward an anti-stigma charter to challenge all of us to consider how we can work together and individually to create a stigma-free Scotland when it comes to issues of drug use. And, you know, I think that is so important, and it's important that we have strategies and charters. The work that's been done here, I think, is exemplary. But this is one area where it comes down to all of us. It is about how we talk about people with drug addiction, how we think about them, how we discuss the issues, the complex issues that are required to be taken forward and progressed here. So each and every one of us has got a role to play to remember that every single person with addiction, every single person who dies with addiction is a human being. It could be, but for a cruel twist of fate away, any one of us. And these are our fellow human beings, they are of our communities, they are of us, and we need to see it that way and make sure that we don't allow stigma to stand in the way of the help and support they need.
Monica Lennon, followed by John Finney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Drug deaths in Scotland have doubled in a decade, and last week I was proud to lead a minute's silence of remembrance in Parliament and for all those who have died during the members' debate on the drug death crisis. And I think that debate did show that the political will does exist right across Parliament to support the national mission the First Minister has outlined today. Many people who are living with substance misuse will feel that they are finally being seen and heard by both the Government and Parliament. So can I ask the First Minister, so that we can keep her eye on the ball here, will she commit to a fuller debate in Government time so we can come back and get regular updates from the Minister? And a very particular point on toxicology, which I'm glad was mentioned today, can we get a commitment, please, that never again people who have lost loved ones to substance misuse and possibly other illnesses and situations will be forced to wait up to a year to find out why their loved one dies, because people need answers a lot quicker than that.
First Minister.
We'd be keen to lead a fuller debate in government time, and I'll allow the Minister to take that forward with our business manager and get that arranged as soon as is practical, and I'm sure we'll come back to this issue regularly to make sure that the actions I've set out today, the ones that we will undoubtedly set out in weeks to come, are scrutinised and taken forward appropriately. On the issue of toxicology, I won't rehearse, not least because Mona Killinan knows them in detail, the reasons behind the delays in the toxicology services, but that is not acceptable, and there is a real determination to make sure that not just that these have been resolved, but that they never occur again. And I did mention today that if necessary, we will commit additional funding to that. There's an associated issue. Monica Lennon is rightly talking about the delays in individuals learning the reasons for the death of their loved ones, but obviously the issues in toxicology has also had a knock-on impact in the publication of statistics. We want timely publication of statistics, but my view, and we have some work to do to get from what I'm about to say to delivering this in practice, but I think we need more regular publication of statistics in order to have more of a real-time overview of whether what we're doing is working or not. I mentioned specifically in the statement, I know it's something the task force is keen on as well, is investment in more public health surveillance so that we have we're not waiting for annual statistics to be published. We know on much more of an ongoing basis whether there are problems like, you know, street benzos, for example, in a particular part of the country or any other issues like that, and an assessment of whether the interventions that we're making are working or not. So making sure that issues in toxicology don't recur, but also making sure that we have much more information and surveillance on an ongoing basis to better tackle some of these issues is at the heart of what I set out.
John Finney, followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank the First Minister for early sight of her statement and welcome the acknowledgement the government has failed, welcome the additional funding, welcome the recognition of the importance of community-based interventions, grassroots organisations and the knowledge of those with lived experience. We need to see support from across the chamber for the Lord Advocate to exempt life-saving services from prosecution. First Minister, there will be three more drug-related deaths today, tomorrow, every other day this week and next. The long-term action is very welcome, but can the First Minister outline what immediate action will be taken to save lives?
First Minister.
I did set out a number of things in my statement. I'll come back briefly to the issue of safe consumption rooms in a second, but you know, while we are continuing to try to overcome the challenges and the barriers there, we, for example, I've said that we will make funding available in this financial year, which doesn't have very long left to run, to rapidly expand heroin assisted treatment services so that more people in more parts of the country can access those. Part of the immediate funding in this financial year will also help to open up more residential rehab placements immediately. And some of what I also set out around getting data sharing agreements in place to better support people after non-fatal overdoses, and also investing funding in this year, here and now, to quickly roll out the standards that the task force has developed for quick and safe access to treatment. So all of these are things that will happen very, very quickly. On the issue of safe consumption, everybody in the chamber who's been involved in these issues knows the complexity of the issues at stake, and I don't think anybody would, and it doesn't help to try to oversimplify those. But I think we all want to see progress on this. I'm not going to trample on the independent terrain of the Lord Advocate here, which is, it's important that I don't do that. When Angela and I met Peter Cracken recently, I undertook to continue discussions with the Lord Advocate and to look almost from first principles at how we overcome these challenges to do the life-saving work that all of us want to do. I'm not going to stand here and say there is an instant, easy solution to some of these things, but there's a real determination to try as hard as we can to get over that. Of course, trying to get the evolution of some of these powers to the Parliament wouldn't be necessarily the quickest way of doing this, but it would be a longer-term solution. But we are going to continue to progress this as firmly and as urgently as we can.
Alex Cole-Hamilton, followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. by rights, we shouldn't be here today. The statement and its actions could have and should have been given in any one of the 14 years the SNP have been in government, and opposition members have been crying out for many of these actions through that time. We've been pleading with the Scottish Government to undertake a number of these actions announced today, particularly since its disastrous 22% cut to ADP budgets in 2016. So it's right that the ambitions of this government are finally being...
Could you come to your question?
I will do. Peter Croykan, as we know, has been saving lives and shouldn't be forced to work in fear of prosecution. And the First Minister says she's looking to international
evidence. Could you
come
to your question,
please? I'm coming to my question. Will she accept the principle that people who are caught in possession of for personal use shouldn't be sent to prison, and that treatment and education is the answer? And will she again look at the Portuguese model?
First Minister.
Look, if I was to stand up here and announce prosecution policy, I would rightly be criticised, because that is not my role. That is the role of the independent Crown Office. I think my views on how we should treat drug addiction and people with issues of drug use from a public health perspective and not a criminal justice perspective, I think, is well known and I hope is well understood. We will continue to look at all different approaches to treatment and services and all opportunities and all ways in which we can overcome any legal challenges we face. And we will look to learn from any other countries where we think that is appropriate.
Can I just say to everyone, we're not going to get through all these questions. We've had quite long answers, but we've also had statements prior to questions, and all that does is disadvantage colleagues. So I'll do the best I can. Can I have Kenneth Gibson, please, followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the First Minister clarify how strategies on adverse childhood experiences and care experienced young people tie into the Scottish Government's prevention strategy, as these have been identified as major causes in pushing younger people into the path of drugs? And the statement says that a clear majority of people who use drugs get the treatment they need when they need it. It has to be central to any strategy for reducing drugs deaths. Will this include same-day treatment, as motivation can fluctuate and waiting be demotivating?
A statement after a question is actually the same effect as a statement before a question. First Minister.
I heard two questions in that, to be honest, but I'll try to keep my answers as brief as I can while doing justice to the questions. In terms of same-day treatment, yes, I think I specifically said that in my statement, that at the heart of the standards is the absolute acceptance that when people come forward to access treatment, they must get that quickly, and that means same day, because for the reasons Kenny Gibson rightly sets out, if that doesn't happen, then somebody can be lost from the ability to access treatment. So that is absolutely the heart of what we're setting out. Secondly, and very briefly, Presiding Officer, adverse childhood experiences are some of the root causes of many of these long-term challenges we face, whether that is drug addiction, alcohol addiction, many of the other problems that we know we have to overcome. So the thinking around ACEs, the learning, the expertise around that has to be absolutely crucial to what we do in trying to tackle drug misuse.
Brian Whittle, followed by Shona Robson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Many of the most vulnerable and marginalised in society are unlikely to walk into a medical facility to ask for help, but they are more likely to build a trusting relationship with a community-based third sector organisation. So I can ask the First Minister, she indicated, how can these organisations access the funds that she said in her statement, and how will the Scottish Government ensure improved collaboration between the third sector and statutory services so finance does flow to these crucial third sector organisations?
First Minister.
Well, the Minister will set out the more detail of the allocation of the funding shortly, and that will include how community organisations can access this, but that will be largely, perhaps not exclusively, but largely through alcohol and drug partnerships. I do believe very strongly that the statutory sector has got obviously a big part to play here, but third sector community organisations have got they already play a big role, but they've got a much bigger role to play and can help us much more in resolving some of these issues if we better support and resource them. And that is why that was a key part of what I set out today.
Shona Robson, followed by Neil Finlay.
Thank you. The First Minister mentioned the huge problem of street benzos in her statement. Can the First Minister say more about what actions are being taken to tackle this issue, which is partly responsible for so many tragic drug deaths in Dundee? And when the work on this, as mentioned in her statement, is likely to come to fruition?
First Minister.
I can't give a particular date for that yet. Angela Constance will keep Parliament updated. there are two elements. I mean, I know I have seen particular problems in my own constituency with street benzos and dreadful, tragic consequences flowing from that. There are two issues that are related, but I think we have to make sure we tackle both of them. One of them is to disrupt supply. Pill presses, for example, the all-too-easy way in which these can be produced and then distributed to street level, and the police have a big part to play in making sure that we are doing everything possible to disrupt that. But the second point, and this has come out very strongly in discussions I've been having in recent weeks, is about stemming the demand and understanding why many people feel that they have to access street benzos, for example, because they're not getting access to treatment as quickly as they need to. They may not be getting the therapeutic dose of methadone that they need to. So we have to understand those reasons so that we are reducing the need that people with drug addiction have to access drugs in that way. So this is a very much a two-pronged thing, but it is an issue of significant importance.
Neil Finlay, please, followed by Emma Harper.
Some of us have been pointing out the failings of the government's approach for years and were arrogantly dismissed and attacked for doing so. But did no one in government really think that a huge cut in ADP budgets might end up with more people losing their lives? And will the First Minister launch an immediate look at the bigger picture and issues of decriminalisation allied with a public health approach and instruct that we have a full independent inquiry into decriminalisation?
First Minister.
This is one of the strands of the Drugs Death Task Force, is to look at the justice system approach to this and legal changes. I think that is very much on the agenda here. I'll take away the suggestion of an independent look at decriminalisation. I know there are mixed views, very mixed views, no doubt across this chamber and across society about whether that would help or hinder, but I certainly am open-minded to further consideration of all of that. And on the point about, you know, past things that have been done, I'm you know, people can decide here, and if people decide they want to keep going back to mistakes or failings, to use how it would be described of the government, that's perfectly legitimate. I'm not complaining about that, because I'm not trying to stand here and defend things that I think we have not got right in the past. So people are perfectly entitled to continue to talk about those things, and I can have no complaint about it. But we have an alternative, which is to accept that we have, I think, a consensus now that there are things we need to do and to do with urgency. And that's what I'm going to focus on. And I know there's an appetite and a willingness across the chamber to do likewise.
Emma Harper, followed by Miles Brixham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Rehab Working Group report published last month said that Scotland lagged behind other European countries in the provision of residential rehab and associated aftercare. Can the First Minister confirm whether the funding announced today will help address that gap and provide additional residential space, such as at River Garden in Ayr in my South Scotland region?
First Minister.
So the funding I've announced today for rehab beds, but also crucially for aftercare, is explicitly there to help end the gap that Emma Harper talks about. And I think that will bring benefits to people with drug addiction, but also to services such as that in our own region that she's talked about. One of the things that has come through the discussions I've been having is a frustration. And I think we sometimes pick this up in all, whether it's methadone or residential rehab, a frustration from those with lived experience that the political debate, and this is all of us, this is not a criticism of anybody, the political debate often focuses on one particular thing. And most recently, that's been residential rehab. It is an important part of this, but we mustn't focus on it to the exclusion of everything else. And that's why the statement I've made today, the actions we've set out, have the balance to them that they do. Residential rehab will be important for some. It will not be appropriate for everybody. And even those who do go to residential rehab, if we don't have the aftercare and the community support as they come out of it, I've heard some people say it often makes things worse, not better. So we have to see this in the round, and that's what we are seeking to do.
I have a short time left for Miles Briggs, please, as the last question.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The First Minister said that she wants to see new and different treatments. Can I ask, therefore, if the Scottish Government will today agree to an independent study of other treatments which are available to us, including NET? And for the families watching today, families who have been forced to sell cars, to sell houses, to sell anything to get their loved ones into treatment, will she also look at establishing a families fund for those affected by these drug deaths?
First Minister.
I think a families fund is a very good suggestion. Actually, one particular organisation in my own constituency that I have known over the years is particularly focused on support for families. So without giving an absolute commitment to any particular funding, to any particular aspect of this today, I think it is something that would be well worth giving consideration to. On the first point, I will certainly take that away and ask the Drugs Death Task Force to consider whether that kind of investigation of other treatments would be helpful over and above the work they are already doing. And I'm happy to feedback once I've had some feedback from them.
That concludes questions on the First Minister's update on drugs policy. Apologies to Bob Doris and Pauline McNeill for not being able to get to the questions. And we'll move on to the next item of business.